Lao friends, so nice to see you all. Mike, I was telling a gathering of some of the believers here from New Zealand that have served in the World Center that it has been my desire to come to New Zealand since I was a child. My parents had gotten me a Viewmaster, the old three-dimensional viewer, you know, and they had scenes from New Zealand, and I used to collect all the other ones and thought, someday I'm going to go to New Zealand. But I never imagined it would be under such happy circumstances as to visit summer school here. You know, I was going to say something, but I don't know if I should say that. I think you're getting the Dunbar leftovers. You know, somebody said, Mr. Dunbar, in a meeting. I said, no, Mr. Dunbar stayed in Haifa. This is Hooper. So that's what you've got. And you should know what you've got, because that's important. Whenever we listen to a Baha'i speaker, we have to put it within the framework of what we know about the cause. I may say some startling things, and you say, yes, I remember that in the teachings, or you may say, that's not Baha'i teachings. But in any case, it sets you to thinking about many different subjects, and that's the whole point of it, is to get you to think about these points, and about the writings, and about who you are, and about why he made you, and about how he views you right now. All this is so important. Time slips away. Abdu'l Baha says, you'll soon be lost under a heap of dust. And then what can you do? So we have to try to always stimulate ourselves, activate ourselves to serve him. And that service should come from love. And that love, he says, is the motivation of why he's made us. And he wants us to love each other, which is a terrific start for all of us, is that that's the magnet that attracts the rest of mankind. If the Baha'is are engaged in unity, spirit of unity and fellowship, all the rest follows. Remember, Shoghi Pindi talks about the energies, creative energies, the bounties of God, unseen, unheralded to some degree, that are diffused by the appearance of the Bab and Baha'u'llah. So much so that he says that period is the heroic age of the Baha'i faith. And that those creative energies, those vital forces sent out into the world are incubating, they're changing us in this formative age of the faith. Another place he says that the creative energies of the faith released during the heroic age are crystallizing into agencies for Baha'u'llah's service in this formative age. Formative, forming, creating, crystallizing, coming into being, so that he can use those instruments which match, if you will, actually are brought into being and designed by the divine purpose for this age. Now, we are all engaged, many of us, in different levels in the agencies and work of the cause, institutions of the cause, and the efficacy of that in part depends upon our own vision and understanding of it. Now, the Baha'is were, sometimes you ask, you know, you hear Baha'is say, well, I try to teach the faith, but nobody's really interested. Usually that's more a comment about ourselves than about the people that are hearing about it from us. There are a lot of people that don't hear, but if we have the right level of excitement and devotion ourselves, then that opens the doors. They get more and more interested. In the last years of Shoghi Effendi's ministry, he was referring with the pilgrims to steps for success. The key to moving ahead effectively in the cause. the key to what he called effective teaching. Lots of teaching going on. How effective is it? Can it be more effective? What are the conditions and circumstances which would make it more effective? And he used to speak about four steps, and that's what it's, you saw this title of the talk, Four Steps to Success. The National Assembly has edited it down to Four Steps to Success, which is fine. But the full title is Four Steps to Success in Baha'i Service. So this is what we're talking about. You'll have to look for other steps for your business affairs and your university studies and all those other things. Although if you do these, that would be successful in that other part too, I think, but they're not directly related to that. There's a letter I'd like to cite from The Guardian to start off. This is, you can, I think that some of these are in the workshop notes that you'll be visiting in the workshop sections. But you can always, I don't want to go on listing all kinds of dates. You can find them, you can get them from me, or you can get them from the National Assembly every year. I've given them a copy of this, okay? So you can find the sources. Shoghi Effendi, through his secretary, writes, he says, when a person becomes a Baha'i, actually what takes place is that the seed of the spirit starts to grow in the human soul. This seed must be watered by the outpourings of the Holy Spirit. These gifts of the Spirit are received through prayer, meditation, study of the holy utterances, and service to the cause of God. This is kind of the intro, if you will, to these four steps. So we have prayer, meditation, study of the holy utterances, and service to the cause of God, which then he also refers to another letter, says action, appropriate action. And you know the House of Justice has stressed the idea that all our studies, all our meditations, all our prayers should be followed by action. They should result in doing something. Of course, there's all different levels of doing, as I'm sure you've all discovered. What do you suppose it means when he says the seed of the Spirit starts to grow in the human soul? Curious, huh? We all come with a soul. We all potentially have the eternal Spirit in us, which is, if you will, a dimension of the soul. We're told here that seed of that Spirit is in the soul. When it hears about the Word of God, it germinates. It comes alive. And as you've seen in dealing with friends and helping friends along in what you might call spiritual, both brotherhood and parenthood, you have to keep helping the people stay focused on the cause. You feed them and you share things with them. And this is the watering, he says. And through the blessings of the revelation, through the Holy Spirit that's watered and brought this power, we're able to nurture these gifts of the Spirit. And we should bring the seekers to an understanding of prayer, and then meditation, and the study of the holy utterances, and finally service to the cause. Shoghi Effendi spoke about different stages in the development of a Baha'i. He says, first is the stage of attraction, where they hear about the cause, people hear about the cause and attracted to it, they like it. And then that attraction moves forward to the stage of confirmation. And confirmation, he relates to the enrollment, becoming Baha'is, actually identifying with the faith. But oftentimes that is as much of an act as it is, it's still passive in character. I know in some of the campaigns in the mass teaching, and I'd ask people, do you want to be a Baha'i? And they'd say, yeah, why not? It's not quite enough to carry you to the kingdom. It's a start. But you have to feed that and develop it, you know. So then the third stage, he said, is consecration. You have to carry the new believers forward. You have to assist them. You have to encourage them until you see them take on the life of prayer, until you see them begin to not need a ride to the 19-day feast or to the Baha'i meetings. They're willing to make an effort to come on their own and bring other people along. And the other sign is that they begin to become aware that they should be contributing financially. They should give of themselves to the work of the cause. Those are the signs that they begin this life of consecration. And then, of course, we've got the rest of our days to hold steadfast in that course and to increase our admiration and appreciation of the teachings by exposing ourselves to them. I've been thinking a lot in recent days about how Abd Baha talks about the gifts of the Spirit circling the human soul as it develops. And he likens that to the embryo, to the child, the embryo of the child in the womb, where the gifts of God, the powers, even of the senses, and of all the different organs of our body, they gradually are waiting for the growth within the embryo of capacity to receive those gifts. It builds up slowly, and then the gifts start coming. Now, Abd Baha says that in our spiritual life, when we're born, and I think that relates to this, when the seed of the Spirit is germinated within our souls, as that grows, the gifts of the Spirit that he promises us depend upon our acquiring capacity for them. I was just seeing this morning in one of the tablets of Baha'u'llah, he says, cleanse your heart so that you may attain to remembrance of God. There's certain stages in our own individual spiritual development in which we then become, we're lifted into what he says, the atmosphere of his presence, or the breezes of his mercy. All these things are so poetic and beautiful, yes, but what do they mean? It's the acquisition through service, through prayer, through meditation, that builds the embryo of our eternal life. The Bab says the paradise that we go to in the next world is constructed of our good actions in this world. So, if you don't want to live in a hut when you get there, and maybe one of those many mansions rather you'd rather find, it depends on what we send ahead, so to speak. And of course, the service in the cause isn't really our service. We ask him to confirm us. We ask him to help us. And through his assistance, something happens. If we identify that as our service, it's not healthy for us. I remember leaving the World Center, 37 years of service at the World Center. I thought, well, I was pretty tired at that point. In the House of Justice, saw how tired I was, and it's time to go to pasture, you know, kind of thing. So, while I was going through my papers at the end of some 25 boxes of papers that accumulated in my office over these years, I found an extract from a tablet of Abd Baha. Simple little phrase, but I think it's useful for all of us. He says, the service of the friends belongs to God, not to them. If by some bounty of God you have performed something, you have done something useful, it belongs to him. You can't claim it for yourself. There's another phrase in the gleanings from the tablets of Baha'u'llah. He says, all good comes from God. Every good thing comes from God. And all evil comes from your own selves. Well, it dwell on that a little bit and you realize you're not going to be able to ever do any good. He does good through you, and it doesn't belong to you anyway. But in the process of working that out, you acquire the capacity that these gifts of the Spirit increase in abundance and lift your thoughts, lift your consciousness into new stages of perception. Abdu'l-Bahá says, you are your thought. That's what you are. Think about your thought. At the end of the day, think, what did I think? What was I thinking about today? Oh, Lord. Did my heart move? Did it turn towards spiritual things? Did I meditate? Did I think about things? I said my prayer this morning. Okay. Did I say the noon prayer? I can't remember. At the end of the day, I was so happy when I reached 70 because I had that problem. We were so busy, we didn't have. Really didn't have a lot of time for the long prayer, although I'm sure I needed it all the time. And then by sundown, I couldn't remember whether I'd said the noon prayer or not. So these simple little pieces. How do we move ourselves forward? How do we keep focused? We are our thought. Abdu'l-Bahá has said that we should hold to thoughts of peace, of unity. We should think well of others. We have to love mankind. He said, God is busy supporting the human race, providing everything it needs. Bounties from every direction. Just the miracle of our physical being. In the Quran it says, will you not see the signs of God in the universe and in yourselves? This is the kind of thing that focuses us. Constantly remembering this, that God is the source of everything. And the verses of God, of course, move us in that direction. So the embryo develops. So the gifts of the Spirit appear. And as they do, as the guardian said about the hands of the cause, he wrote the Persian hands of the cause. He said, now that the trees of your service have borne heavy fruits, the branches must bend low so that the people have access to them. And also the sign of the humility that the hands should have amongst the friends. Beautiful idea, you know. If you've got a lot of fruit on your tree, your branches have to bow down very low. Give access to others. Let's go back to a few other quotations from the Guardian about these four steps. In another message he says, success will crown the efforts of the friends on the home front when they meditate on the teachings, pray fervently for divine confirmations for their work, study the teachings so that they may carry their spirit to the seeker, and then act, and above all, persevere in action. When these steps are followed, the teaching work carried on sacrificially and with devoted enthusiasm, the faith will spread rapidly. The Hand of the Cause, Bill Sears was quite a humorist. Maybe some of you have read things of his. I used to laugh myself to sleep in the early days with God Loves Laughter and just other books. He made a few cartoons which made their way to the presence of the Guardian. One of them is a cartoon picture of a desert island about 12 feet in diameter with a single palm tree on it and a bedraggled pioneer standing in the water, just pulled a bottle out of the water, and there's a message in them. He's got the message out. And he's looking at the message, and the message says, persevere, Shoghi. I understand the Guardian had a good laugh about that when he saw it. So perseverance in action is an important element of the action. Again, the Guardian says, the keynote of success in the teaching field is study of the word, prayer, meditation and then action. Above all, perseverance in action. When these steps are followed in the realm of self-sacrifice, success will be achieved. Now, friends, the reason I kind of focused on these points, this question of these four steps to success and effective teaching, effective action in the service of the cause, is because sometimes we get carried away with the goals and we occupy ourselves with action and more activities. And I've been through seven stages of, what is it, this program of action, and I'm exhausted. And I hear the friends saying, you know, I don't have any more push. That probably is a sign that we're not doing the first three steps along with the action. Think of these steps. They're all internal to us. They're all with regard to the orientation, the direction we're facing in our services, so that the action will be effective. Otherwise, we're just acting, even when we're acting nice. There's a story from Julia Thompson. She was with the master in Washington. At one moment, the master turned to her. He said, "Juliet, proofs. Smiles are not enough." And that's the point. You can be nice, but we need to, through the study of the writings, through this communion, because actually the prayer is, of course, drawing close to Baha'u'llah, that he can draw close to us. Through that, then the divine truths that we're reading stick with us, and we become instruments for their sharing, and that's what sets the other hearts on fire. Quality of action. To the hands of the cause of God in the United States, serving in the United States, the Guardian wrote the year before he passed away through his secretary, "The beloved Guardian has stressed over and over again that to effectively teach the faith, the individual must study deeply the divine word, imbibe its life-giving waters, and feast upon its glorious teachings. He should then meditate on the import of the word, and finding its spiritual depths, pray for guidance and assistance. But most important, after prayer, is action. After one has prayed and meditated, he must arise, relying fully on the guidance and confirmation of Baha'u'llah, to teach his faith. Perseverance in action is essential." Same principle he mentions again. "Just as wisdom and audacity are necessary for effective teaching, perseverance, wisdom, and audacity. The individual must sacrifice all things to this great goal, and then the victories will be won." Shoghi Effendi said that the cause progresses on sacrifice. Sacrifice is the fuel of the faith. We can all do our duty as Baha'is, go to feast, do everything we do. Do as much as we can do, and the cause will be maintained. But if we want it to grow, we have to do more than we can do. We have to push beyond that limit of our own idea of how much we can serve. That's a challenge that's in each of us as individuals. We have to think, how much time, how much energy am I putting in this? Can I put more? And inspire me, oh God, inspire me to what I can do that would make that difference. Then the sacrifice comes, and the sacrifice impels us forward. A car with no gas, he said, doesn't go anywhere. Also, the car has to be moving for God to guide you where to go. You say, oh God, guide me where to go when you're sitting down. Action. You're moving. He can adjust. And even, Shoghi Effendi says in another place, even if you go in the wrong direction, he can change your course. I saw something that the Master had said the other day. He said that even the mistakes of the sincere friends, God will use for the progress of the cause. I said, thank God. Two more short letters referring again to these steps. Study of the Word, meditation on its divine import, prayer, and then action are necessary, and then perseverance in action. If these steps are followed, one will develop spiritually and be victorious in service to the cause of God. Friends, I think these are the steps essential to arising to serve the cause as the House of Justice is calling upon us in the current stage of the unfoldment of the divine plan in the epoch that we are. Finally, he says, and this is just 2 months before his passing, 3 months before his passing, teaching is the source of divine confirmation. It is not sufficient to pray diligently for guidance, but this prayer must be followed by meditation as to the best methods of action, and then action itself. Even if the action should not immediately produce results or perhaps not be entirely correct, that does not make so much a difference, because prayers can only be answered through action. And if someone's action is wrong, God can use that method of showing the pathway which is right. Again, we have this. If we're moving, then there'll be assistance will come to us. From these few letters, you also get an idea about meditation. We should pray, we should meditate. People will ask, what is meditation? We're going to have a session on that. But the hints are given here. Meditate on the divine import of the word that you've been studying, for example, is one of the keys to effective, proper meditation. And meditation as to the best methods of action in your circumstances. Then the action itself. Large subject, prayer, meditation, study, and action. Terrific realms that we're constantly involved in, if you will. We're going to move on because the subject of prayer particularly is a fairly hefty amount of material, and meditation also. So I'm going to take a little of this first day to move on to the subject of prayer. Although you'll notice he sometimes places the four steps in different orders. There may be times when, you may be taking action and you have to resort to prayer, and then you'll think about what to do next. And all of those things are there. The foundation of the cause is the same foundation as all of the previous phases, if you will, of divine revelation. And that is belief in God through the manifestation of God. And then after that, conforming our lives and our actions to the commandments of God. It's so simple that it kind of evades us, Why has Baha'u'llah come? He's come to enable us to make safe passage to this life into the life to come. The secret to that is belief, acceptance in the manifestation of God, and obedience, strict obedience, he says, to his commandments. none of us are perfect. We have that wonderful letter from the Guardian that says no one is perfect. Abdullah also says this is not the world of perfections. We have to try to acquire them, but we don't always succeed. I like all that. It seems to match my personal circumstances. So take heart in that, you know. If you're not perfect yet, well, there's hope still, because this world is preparing you to be perfect later on, so to speak. I used to always tell the youth in the Holy Land, you know, if you fall down, what do you do? Get up. You got to get up again. It's part of, falling down is part of the life experience that we have here. We all are visited with tests. Dr. Getzinger was talking to Abdu'l-Bahá and he wrote down some notes. He said Abdu'l-Bahá was speaking about how we overcome shortcomings. The test comes to us, he said. Abdu'l-Bahá said, God sends the test. And we think, okay, I have to overcome some problem in my character or some actions of mine that are inappropriate. What shall I do? He said, I can handle this. And we go on with we try to resist the test. And it comes again, and we fail. Okay, well, you know, you can't win them all, so I try again. I get myself up, and I face the test again, and I fail again. And Abdu'l-Bahá says this continues for a time until the soul gets desperate, because it's given its best, and he can't change himself. He can't change herself from what she was doing that they don't want to do anymore. Sound familiar? Then Abdu'l-Bahá says the soul becomes desperate and it falls on its face and it begs God. It says, I can't overcome my shortcomings. Please take this from me. And then Abdu'l-Bahá says the test comes again and it's not a test anymore. Of course, there's another one right behind it, but another shortcoming we're going to have to address. But it depends. The mystery of success in all this process is turning to God, really submitting yourself to Him, knowing that He's there when you pray. Know that Baha'u'llah can hear you, and asking Him to help. And staying humble in the process, because all evil comes from your own self. And all good comes from Him. It makes it so easy. I think that the formula is easy, but it sinks into us right away. I don't know. It takes time to understand. So that's the opening paragraph of the Most Holy Book. Again, in this day, it's renewed. The first duty is the recognition of the manifestation of God. After that, strict observance of His laws. After that, what is the first law that He brings up? Obligatory prayer. The role of the manifestation of God is something we want to be thinking about a lot. And surely part of the reason Shoghi Effendi emphasizes the Egan, and it was one of the earliest books that he translated, the Book of Certitude, because it portrays in a way and with a fullness the role of the manifestation of God in our existence. Beyond anything, we have some hints in past scriptures, but this opens it up. Just a single line of Baha'u'llah where he says, all things live and move and have their being in the manifestation of God. Read these passages. He said that creation is an outpouring from the will of God. It's an emanation. It emanates out. It is full of configurations and it becomes our world of existence where we live here. But it's all sustained by Him. He says if for an instant His support was not there, it would all come to nothing. Abdu'l-Bahá says that if it were not for the powers of the Holy Spirit, in our being, we would not think, we would not have consciousness. Even consciousness itself is not. We have the impression it belongs to us. We have the impression we're kind of our own boss and we can choose. Yes, we can choose. The Bab says free will has been given to us to choose the will of God. Any other use of it is illicit, inappropriate. So deciding, you know, where am I going to take my holiday this year doesn't come under that category exactly. We need to be thinking in terms of using free will to choose the will of God. And when do we do that? How do we know? People say, well, I know what the will of God is. Well, what's the first step in knowing what the will of God is? Would you say reading his teachings, seeing what he's asking us to do? That's sometimes I say, I can't know the will of God. Paula came here, sacrificed himself to leave us the will of God in the form, written form, in his holy books, so that he can guide us, he can lift us. Do we absorb them? Do we make them a part of our understanding? Do we transform our consciousness? Do we replace acquired knowledge, borrowed knowledge, university knowledge? Do we replace that with the truth and reality of the texts as we encounter them? In other words, our minds, our thoughts are remade through our encounter of the revelation. And recognition of the manifestation, I think, is very closely related to absorbing his teachings. We become Baha'is, we're like people standing in the street watching a parade. This is terrific, you know. Parade is going by, it seems to have been going by forever, I don't know. I've just come and heard about it, and I love it. It's beautiful. And then one of the... Maybe someone suggests to us that, you know, if we go in this building behind us and go up five floors, we can see more of the parade. And so we absorb, we go into the, if you will, the house of God's teachings, and we go up to the second, third, fourth floor, and we look at the parade, and it looks different to us now. We're seeing a greater length of it. And eventually he tells us, come all the way to the roof. And then there you see the beginning of the parade and the end of the parade all in one vision. And this is kind of an analysis, I think, of how we grow in our understanding of the teachings. We should know that the levels of teaching are as many, they're infinite levels, and each one of these is related to a state of the soul. And those states of the soul are something that are also emanated. In fact, that state of the soul is already projected into us. It's in us, but we're not aware of it yet. We don't have the means in our thought and consciousness. We haven't acquired the preliminaries to be able to perceive those things. And we give up too soon. And if we don't focus enough attention on it, we don't see that successive growth in our vision and understanding. And then our excitement is reduced. And we need that excitement to communicate the faith on the day of God to other people. You'll recall, perhaps in reading from the Gan, there's a section about the meaning of heaven and of the sun and of the moon. And Baha'u'llah cites a verse from the Islamic teachings where it says that religion is a heaven, fasting is its sun, and obligatory prayer is its moon. And in various tablets, he himself restates this. So of the whole domain of the new revelation of, if you would say, the Baha'i faith, the greatest luminary in the heaven of this religion is fasting. And the moon, also revolving around us, and a constant source of illumination in our darkness, so to speak, is obligatory prayer. Obligatory prayer has a station that excels the other prayers. It's been endowed, Shoghi Effendi says, with a special potency. Fasting, of course, we have these wonderful long prayers, not simply to deprive ourselves of food, but to engage in reading these wonderful tablets related to fasting, prayers on a regular basis. All of that has a terrific transformative capacity. Well, we made the compilation on obligatory prayer and fasting. Perhaps you've seen the importance of that. So the World Center of the House of Justice published this as it was increasing our understanding. It's part of the process of increasing our understanding of the laws of the Kitabi Akdas. In the course of doing that, we found a tablet which in the end didn't get included. I think we maybe thought we'd have questions and we don't want to know how to answer them. Baha'u'llah says that the fast is like a spider web. So you say, what in the world? But think of the spider. It's a little spider. He spins this big web. And in that web, he catches all kinds of morsels that he could never catch without the assistance of the web. And the fast is like that. We don't want to, he says, beware lest desire deprive you of the bounties of the fast. Somehow we have to share with the new believers and help them to take on the idea of the fast. It's so, such an important, essential thing. Then he also said, it's like a dam. The fast is like a dam. Well, what does the dam do? It stores up water so that it can be used all year. Outside the rainy season, you can also have all the water you need. So maybe that's another thing. It's bounties that accrue to the soul during fasting we use for the whole rest of the year, so to speak. And then we come fresh onto it again. You know, this year with the change of the calendar, we're going to fast one day earlier than we ever have. That's curious change that we have. And Nowruz is going to come forward today too. So that, along with the other words of both Baha'u'llah and Abdul Baha about obligatory prayers, are important to that we fix those in our hearts. You know, and the pillars of spiritual growth, obligatory prayer and fasting, he said, they're two wings to the soul, he says in another place. They're the two columns that support the Word of God and our spiritual development. Some people say, well, these are so different, you know, I don't know, I haven't ever had an experience of having to move a certain way in the prayer. Abdu'l Baha says, know thou that in every word and movement of the obligatory prayer, there are allusions, mysteries, and a wisdom that man is unable to comprehend, and letters and scrolls cannot contain. The practice, the use of the obligatory prayer gradually reveals its importance to us. And Shoghi Effendi used to suggest to the believers, warn the pilgrims, he said, you have to be careful that it doesn't become rote. That you're not, you know it. Oh, it's time then. I bear witness. And then at sundown, you can't remember whether you said it or not again. How do we do that? How do we make it real for ourselves? How do we think about it? Should we maybe study portions of the obligatory prayer apart from when we're saying it, just to meditate and think about the implications of what it means? And realizes that it gives wings to the soul. Realize that it is one of the great means that... Somebody wrote The Guardian, they said, you know, something like... I don't think they were writing about transcendental meditation or one of these Eastern movements where you know, empty yourself of all things and then God fills you up or something. Why hasn't Baha'u'llah said anything on this? Or has he said anything? The Guardian wrote back, no, he hasn't said anything. And the friends must trust that Baha'u'llah, the supreme manifestation of God for 500,000 years, if there was something essential to your spiritual growth, He wasn't going to leave off mentioning it. So it can't be that important. But these things he has said, this is essential. Fasting and obligatory prayer in accordance with the revelation. Drawing on that great tradition of prayer and meditation in previous religions, previous revelations, is essential for our spiritual growth. One component of prayer. Okay, we have the other prayers that we're praying for confirmations in service to his faith. And Abdu'l-Bahá gives these wonderful prayers of the tablets of the divine plan to help us with that, help us focus, help us think. And he has us declare all our lack of qualities or our lowliness in those prayers, which also is the appropriate position that we should be in relation to receiving divine confirmations. Again, if the friends think that they are the means of changing souls, he said they will find themselves swept aside. We have to constantly give acknowledgement and praise that he has helped us. He has made this possible for us. Abdu'l-Bahá in another tablet says, the obligatory prayers are binding inasmuch as they are conducive to humility and submissiveness, to setting one's face towards God and expressing devotion to him. Through such prayer, man holdeth communion with God, seeketh to draw near unto him, converseth with the true beloved of one's heart, and attaineth spiritual stations. Again, Shoghi Effendi in a letter says, the obligatory prayers are by their very nature of greater effectiveness and are endowed with a greater power than the non-obligatory ones, and as such are essential. That doesn't mean that the rest of the prayers are anything but better than the rest of creation, so to speak, as far as I can see. You know, if you move into the realm of prayer, all right, obligatory prayers have a special station, but all the other prayers are also very essential for us. We have so many marvelous prayers, occurs to me, for the departed. You'll be seeing more of them in the future. They've been published in Persian and Arabic, a number of them. Or our mothers, for our fathers, for our relatives, for our departed spouses, for our children, for so many marvelous prayers related to going to the next world. I have never seen one that doesn't beg forgiveness for the soul. You all need that. I mean, we're dependent upon divine forgiveness. He says, if it were not for his mercy, he's given us all these instructions. The way we carry them out, we'd be in big trouble. But he says the mercy of God exceeds his justice, so he somehow moves us along, supports us. What about when to pray? That's an interesting subject. When to pray? We know from with the obligatory prayers, they have fixed times. Even the long one has a fixed time, he said, because you should say it at the time you feel attracted to say it. Now, maybe you say, I never feel attracted to say it. Okay, that's possible. If that's the case, then you should pray, oh God, help me to feel what time of day I should say this prayer or when I should say the prayer. Okay. From the Akdas itself, he says, recite ye the verses of God every morn and eventide. Whoso faileth to recite them hath not been faithful to the covenant of God in his testament. And whoso turneth away from these holy verses in this day is of those who throughout eternity have turned away from God. Now the verses of God, of course, include the prayers, and there were letters to Abdu'l-Bahá, to the guardian about this. Do prayers fulfill this requirement of reciting the verses morning and evening? He said, yes, but not just the prayers. All the verses, all the tablets relate to that. Occupy thyself in remembrance of the beauty of him who is the unconstrained at early morn, and seek communion with him at the hour of dawn. One of the hadiths of Muhammad says that God draws close to the souls the last third of the night. Baha'u'llah himself says, you know, we came to visit you at dawn, but we found you busy on a bed with somebody else. The prayerful condition is the best of all conditions. For man in such a state communeth with God, especially when prayer is offered in private and at times when one's mind is free, such as at midnight. Indeed, prayer imparteth life. It's from the Master. This is in a marvelous compilation the House of Justice published in 1980 called The Devotional Life, Prayer, Meditation, and the Devotional Attitude. Wonderful things that hadn't been previously published. Again, the Master says, praise be to God, thy heart is engaged in the commemoration of God. Thy soul is gladdened by the glad tidings of God, and thou art absorbed in prayer. The state of prayer is the best of conditions, for man is then associating with God. Prayer verily bestoweth life, particularly when offered in private and at times such as midnight, when freed from daily cares, which is partly a repetition of the previous one. What should we be praying for? It's another dimension of prayer. Abdu'l-Bahá says in a tablet, beseech thou from God, from God's infinite grace, whatsoever thou desirest. But wert thou to heed my advice, thou wouldst desire not save entrance into the Abha kingdom, and seek not save the bounties of the beauty of the All-Glorious. May my life be sacrificed for his loved ones. This is my exhortation to thee. And another place he talks about, he said, you know, God is great, and he responds to prayers. But Abdu'l-Bahá says, if you pray for something that you don't know if it's the will of God or not, he may give it to you, and it wouldn't be good for you. How many times we might be too specific. Oh God, I want to get in this university. Or, oh God, if I could just get this job. Or, oh God, how about a Lamborghini? Or, oh God. He says, so trust in him. He knows what's best for you. We have to trust. We're saying the obligatory prayers. We've embraced his cause. We've accepted his revelation. He's moving us through patterns in our life that we have to trust that that's the best thing for us. And that's always hard. We always want something else, some other condition. We should be asking for the things he has us ask for in his own prayers that he's revealed for us. That moves us forward, obviously. And if you do have to ask for a new house or whatever it is, you want to say if it's in accordance with your will, I think that old Baha'is have taught us that, you know, always add that on the prayer. Should it be your wish, could you do this? If it is in agreement with your bounty and purpose. Otherwise, we're going to bring on. Imagine you say, you pray for wealth and you get wealthy. There were people that asked Baha'u'llah, they say, can you give me wealth? Please give me wealth. Baha'u'llah said, all right. The guy becomes rich and he wanders away from the faith. Then after that, he loses it all. Okay, comes back to Baha'u'llah, source of wealth. He recognizes that was the source of wealth. He comes back, asks him again for this. or the wealth. That's just like, we don't want to do too much of that. Trust in Him, hold Him. Bit of time now. That was so. We're into this. We're going to talk a little bit about the need for prayer. You already get an idea from what we've been reading, and where to direct our prayers, what manner we should direct our prayers. We'll talk about that tomorrow morning, along with meditation. Lovely to be here, friends. Thank you very much.